It's my fourth book and a free download on my website. Tonight, the guides will be answering your questions about reincarnation, the universe's recycling system, why you came back this lifetime. What are you laughing at, Ray?
That's funny. The universe's recycling system. Be right back.
As I'm reading the excerpt from Linda's weekly guided insight, and after the guides provide their opening message to you, listen to the message you got. Feel what that was like. Write your realizations in part 3 of your journal and share with us what that was. When someone says, "I'll be right back," they mean it. This is especially true when a person crosses over from this lifetime. They will be right back sooner than they think. As reincarnation is the universe's recycling system, coming back to this world is a natural process in the progression of the soul's evolution. We use Ask the Universal Channel for your guides to communicate their messages to you. And Ray is the one they assigned to speak their messages out on this board. Ask the Universal Channel is a trademarked product of our parent company, Channeled Readings. Now, the guides will open this session about reincarnation, the universe's recycling system. And like always, we take a moment, just a moment, and you should always do this before you attempt to make that connection with your own guides, okay? Is breathe, and I mean really breathe, okay? Breathe. And do we have anyone on, Ray?
So we do.
And breathe with us, okay? And when we breathe, you're looking for that yawn breath so that that really releases everything. You want to stretch out your upper body, your arms, your neck, your shoulders, your back. You want to stretch it all out, and that'll encourage you to breathe. Ah, and there it is. That's that yawn breath that I always reach for before I go into session, whether it's with you guys on Tuesday night and Ray, or in a coaching session with you, private coaching session. Always catch that breath, and the guides have no problem accessing us so they can communicate to you, okay? And they're going to open this session about reincarnation, the universe's recycling system, and why you came back. And here they go.
Good evening. Why do you reincarnate? It's because you have unfinished business. Why is it unfinished? It didn't get done because you lost focus. When the body wants to learn something new, it forces the mind to focus. The mind must pay attention. Finished business needs 3 things: focus, direction, and resolve in order to finish. You live in a world of distractions and separateness. This causes two problems. First, the distractions make it harder to sustain a complex thought and complex tasks. It's a lack of concentration. Everything around you is creating distractions. Smartphones and gadgets. Political nonsense. Sports. Entertainment. Fake news. Religious wars. Everything is a distraction. People like to say, and we do believe they realize that everyone is connected. We are all one. But all the distractions that you encounter daily are designed to create separateness in people. It's my team, my religion, my political party. Everything is designed to polarize people. This lack of concentration leads to a lack of commitment. People just don't seem to be able to commit to anything long term. They jump from job to job, from relationship to relationship, and start and stop endless projects. People wander around through life looking for easier paths to follow rather than just clearing off their own.
Yeah. It's almost normal. It's gotten to the point where it's normal, and it's far from normal as far as producing results in your life. You come into this life. Imagine, this is how I look at it. You come into this life as a new person, a baby, dependent on the parents that you picked. I hope you picked good parents, right?
You picked them.
But the problem, the whole point is, how much of a challenge did you set yourself up for next time, all right? And there's going to be a next time. So we want to get this as right as we can in this life. In other words, give the soul as much as it can possibly get, as you can work toward and accomplish in this life, so that when you do come back the next time, you're going to be wiser. Okay, you're going to, like I explained before, when you come in from where you came from into this world, the same place that when you're released from this life that you go back to and recycle, there's that recycling system. When you come back in, you are more enlightened when you come in. So that when you come in, you are less nervous, you are less demanding, you are less frightful and fearful, dependent on everybody else to take care of you. Now, as a baby, you hardly have a choice. But it's a real crapshoot. You come back into another life, it's like, oh, please. I hope that my parents are supportive of me. I hope they don't push me, try to push me into things that I have to fend off. I have to go, oh, don't do that to me. I have to be who I am, you know? And there's always going to be something. You come in, you're going to disappoint people. We disappoint each other. We don't mean to do it. Well, some people do mean to do it. Some people aren't nice. But we come back into this imperfect world again to get this right. So, you know, try to get it as right as you can and work through as much as you can. So when you come back, you're more perfected and you have more to work with the next time around. That's the whole point. And the next time around and the next, until guess what? At one point, you really will evolve. You will move through this dimension and the need to experience what's here and move up the ladder. All right.
You know, they mentioned a couple of things in their opening statement that the reason all this, you have all this unfinished business is because you lost your focus. You have a lack of focus and, what they say, concentration.
Right, right.
And you have a lack of commitment. People jumping around from, relationship to relationship or job to job or
right.
project to project. Everybody's got an endless stream of projects they got half done.
Right. You may as well have not even started them.
Well, that's right. So you come back. I think there's something else in play here. You come back soon after you leave here, I think. I believe that. I mean.
Well, you did.
I did. I was right back.
Ray did. Ray, from his last life, he came back almost immediately. All right.
Got out of one car, jumped in the next Uber one that came by, and here I am. But the other problem is we don't live long enough.
That's why we keep coming back.
We don't live long enough, you know, 70, 80, 90 years. That's really not long enough to evolve spiritually.
But it is. If you're aware of the fact that you don't live long enough to evolve spiritually, then you know that you better get going on this. You better start working on this. You better learn to focus and stay on track with what that is and see it through and perfect it. When you perfect it, what you're really perfecting, because you don't take that with you when you move on, you're perfecting the soul. You're perfecting the reason you came here, one of your missions while you were here. That's what you're perfecting, okay? So what do we have, Ray?
Well, I mean, I have a comment. Ray has a question. I mean, that's why people say life's too short.
Yeah.
They're afraid they're not going to get all their business done before it's time to leave.
Then see, with all the distractions we have to really take note of those distractions and put them on a diet, a budget. You know, control that distraction and get your life back. Really start focusing on what that is and get to work on it, okay? I'm really a stickler about that. Myself, oh, every project I ever went after, I go right after it. Ask Ray. I'm relentless. I don't give up. I don't stop. I get to the point where I'm so tired I can hardly think. And then I know I need to take and rest. But then I feel like, man, maybe I'm just pushing too hard. And you know what? The next day I'm right back at it, because of what Ray said. The only thing we have in this lifetime, you guys, is our time. People say all you have is your money or, you know, whatever. That isn't true. Money, you can't take it with you. The time you have been allocated, the lifespan, to get done what you came here to do is really important. If for no other reason, the next time you get recycled and come back here, that you're on the ball. You've got more going, much more going for yourself than you did when you came into this lifetime, okay? Yeah.
Okay, and then the other things that they talked about were everybody's bombarded with distractions.
I know.
And feeling separate. When we know we're not separate, we know we're all connected. We're connected to everything. We're children of the universe.
And what that does is that is a, that's where we compete with other people. Okay. Right. And when we find ourselves comparing and competing and that kind of thing, then you know that you've gotten lost. Okay. That is totally off track. And as far as you could be from achieving what you came here to do, the reason you came here, that's just like a great big block of a waste of time that you can look at back at later on and go, wow, I could have done without that. I could have gotten all this done had I not been focused on that, that which is so unproductive. And it gave me, it actually set me back because it put all the wrong ideas in my head that I now have to flush out, okay? So I look at it like I see a lot of people just, they'll talk gibberish or they'll spend time thinking about nonsense or just watching TV all the time. Whoa, that's like being in a stupor. It's a waste of your time. So be aware of your time. It's your time that you have while you're here and using that time to keep yourself healthy so you can think clearly and you can do what you focus on and stay true to that and see that through, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. Nicole. Hi, Nicole. She's so happy to be back here. You both look wonderful. We do, don't we?
Oh, that's so sweet.
You look wonderful, dear.
Well, you do too, Ray. You always do. He always talks about his hair. You know, these guys have this thing about their hair, Nicole.
Yeah.
I don't know. We are into our, you know, how our hair looks. But these guys, oh my God, what they do to make them, they think they have to do all this. Ray's got great hair. He doesn't need to do anything.
You know, today I have the slick back look because it's for the windy Phoenix weather.
And it's hot. So I put mine up.
Degrees or something.
I try to leave my hair down sometimes, but it's so hot where we live that and when we do these sessions, I get really warm.
Yep.
So around my neck, I got to get the hair off my neck. So I said to Ray one day, I said, you know, I'm thinking about chopping my hair. He goes, don't you dare cut your hair. So this is what I come up with. Okay, Ray, what do we have?
Okay, so some observations. And okay, Nicole says, do you think that people from the Bible times lived longer than we do now? That they were given more of an opportunity to evolve in one lifetime or maybe two? How do you know what stage of evolution you're at? She believes we come back to overcome various areas of our soul, you know, to improve things that we, the hole in your soul.
Right,
to
right.
Come back and fix that hole in your
right,
soul.
Right, right. To work things out.
Right.
We need to stop, and we need to take this down from the top.
Okay.
Okay, so
People in the Bible, did they really live longer, which made them, gave them more time to evolve?
Okay, and we're going to let the guides talk about that, Nicole. And it's really all the guides, all of our guides that are going to answer that, all right?
The stories of Scripture often enhanced the facts. People lived 100, 200, or more years. Not really. The times and the nutrition of the times didn't allow it. Occasionally, a certain individual would live into their 70s or 80s.
Right, so that's false. Okay, and so what they might be referring to, and I'm going to just say this, is 200 or 300 years and maybe longer. That was where other life, other beings from other planets came onto this planet and participated with humanity. And in those days, the biblical days.
And before that.
And even now, they come through to enhance our awareness, to help us evolve. Because, you know, we need to evolve. We're like the ripple effect. We have to evolve so that ripple effect, so they can evolve. And it's a chain reaction, you know.
And we're holding them back.
Well, we all hold each other back if our awareness isn't there. And some of those beings from other dimensions, galaxies, whatever, they live different lifespans than we do. So they do have more time to evolve. And it could be that they came in and participated with humanity at the time that you're talking about. Of course, it's happened throughout humanity. And they live different lifetimes, lifespans. And that's where that interpretation was probably picked up. It was assumed it was the humans, when in fact, it was beings from other planets and other dimensions, other places, okay? And that's where that's really what happened. That's what that was about. And they did have the time.
Yeah, if you live 200 or 300 years or 500 years, you have a lot of time to spiritually evolve, plus you have a lot of time to contribute.
That's the whole point. That's the, see, when you spiritually evolve truly, this is going to be your litmus test. When you know, when you'll know when you spiritually evolved, because your desire to share that and help and be of service to others becomes stronger. All right, so that's when you know that you are on your way, when you're getting it. When you, as a unit, a single unit, a person, an individual, an entity, is carrying their own load in this spiritual evolution, all right? Because we all have to carry our own load. Nobody gets to cheat, you know? So what's the other part to that, Ray?
She's got some, mostly not questions, but observations.
I know. And I like it.
Yeah, and these are all kind of interwoven.
Yeah.
How do you know what stage of evolution you're at?
That's the next thing they're going to answer, Nicole, and here they go.
How many birthdays have you had? And where does that put you on the stick of life? If you look at each candle on the cake, it represents 1 year you have extinguished.
Okay, but that's not the question. Read the question again.
How do you know where you are?
Right. That did not answer it.
If the average age a person lives is 75 or 80 years old, you know how much time you have left here, but you don't know how far you will have evolved by the time you leave.
Okay, each person is different. So the question is pretty general, and it doesn't apply to every person, all right? So let's take that question again. I want that question back.
Okay.
Read it.
How do you know what stage of evolution you are at? Well,
okay.
It depends
let's
how you
talk
came
about,
in.
Okay, let's talk about you, Nicole, because this isn't a general answer to a question, all right, Ray?
Mm-hmm. You, like everyone else, had unfinished business. Are you 50% evolved? Or 30 or 80? As you evolve, you become a greater being. Therefore, you can evolve more quickly each time you reincarnate.
Right. So where's Nicole on the evolution, the stick of evolution?
Two-thirds.
That's pretty good, Nicole. Okay. So, and you've lived with many lifetimes.
You'd be an old soul.
Here's the point. The hard work has been done up to the two-thirds, right, is what they're saying.
Mm-hmm.
It's once you get your momentum going, like you have, the last one-third won't take as long as the first one-third or the second one-third. The last one-third will go much quicker. as long as you don't let yourself get off track. Don't start losing momentum now and stay true to yourself. That's the key. And you'll move through this last third and you'll evolve and you will transcend this third dimension and move to the fourth, all right?
Okay. She has one more good observation here. We're here to contribute,
right,
like they said,
right,
in the open. But what are we contributing to? And she also believes that when we're not here and we're on the other side, we're contributing to something over there.
Okay.
Also.
Okay.
So what is it that we're contributing to?
Here they go. This is a general answer to that general question, all right?
It's like we said about the separateness. People all realize when they do get to the other side that everything is connected. All is one. Therefore, whether you realize that when you are in this world or not, you are still contributing to the same thing. You are contributing to the benefit of the oneness.
It's a big question. It's also a big answer. And everybody's in a different place when it comes to their ability, their capacity to contribute with what they have to work with. Even people who don't seem to be evolved, they do contribute. Maybe they love animals, even though they're not really evolved. They take care of animals. Well, that's pretty good. I mean, they're contributing something pretty amazing there. Or maybe they like kids, but they're not really spiritually evolved. They're kind of silly.
Or plants.
It doesn't matter. There's something that they do, that they love to do, and they're true to. They see to it that they do it. And that's important. Every yep. single thing that you do that contributes. Now let's take the opposite end of that. Let's say somebody's judgmental or sarcastic. You know, they're nasty. Now it's like they've come along and they've evolved. Now they slip back down the ladder. They really do. They get sloppy and lazy and they make fun of their evolution. They lose it. They pay a price for that. So you don't want to engage with that because you slip back with them. It's really offensive to me because it separates and it's mean, you know? If it's mean, it separates. If it's not kind and loving, it separates. If it excludes, it separates.
Right.
Yeah.
Like the distractions are all to get you to become separate from other groups or other people.
From yourself.
Or from yourself.
Yeah, from yourself.
Right.
Because here you were focused on something and something happened and you're like, what?
Yeah, here you are feeling good. I feel really good. You know,
right.
You're real happy with your... And you see a TV commercial that for some new pill, that for some new disease that they made up. And
that really gets to Ray.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So don't go there, Ray. Okay. So where are we now, Ray?
Okay, Linda Bach. Oh, well, first of all, one last comment from Nicole. She says she has had a great week working through the journey, through my guided journey, received some clear whispers. Thank you for helping me.
Okay, now, Nicole, as we move through these weeks, I want to hear what happened. I want you to share.
Share with the group, yeah.
Yeah, share with us what happened. And when you do, your guides are going to come through, and I promise you, you're going to have that feedback from your guides. So do put that into the feed so we can talk about that and have the guides talk to you about that, all right? Good job.
Okay, Linda Baca Goodwillie says, Linda and Ray, I realize I'm here for a higher purpose at a later age in my life. I must make a difference in this lifetime. Somehow I know that much. When my guides and angels tell me what my purpose for this reincarnation was, this one here, She feels passion to help others in a meaningful way, and could they give her some direction, advise her as how she's supposed to serve?
Okay. And really, what happened, Linda, is you weren't ready to start serving until you got to a certain point in your life. You didn't have it all there yet, where you felt comfortable about taking that on and then being of service to others, where you feel strong with it now, okay? So I'm going to kind of get on your side there instead of get on your back, because you can't punish yourself for what you needed. You were collecting information all that time, important information, so you were of value at the point that you are now, all right? And they're going to answer that. Your spirit guides and angels are here with us now, Linda, and they are going to explain this to you, where you are.
We want you to stop worrying about running out of time. We see that you are aware of your situation and what it is you feel you need to do. Rather than forcing it and saying things like, I want to be of service, I want to discover my service to others' calling in this life, it's good to take the ego out of it. When you say, I must, you are saying that I have something to gain from it, and I want or must is based in desire. And when you say, I want to have service to others, just say, I'm being service to others. I feel like I'm giving what I can in this lifetime to be of service. Stop putting unnecessary pressure on yourself.
Right, right, right. You know, that's something that I think everybody who starts to realize that they start to wake up. Mm-hmm. They start to feel this urgency hit them. It's like in an instant, you're aware of the fact that you've been, that ice is really making a lot of noise, Ray. That's distracting. Anyway, you feel like all of a sudden you need, what happened? I need all this information and I need it as fast as I can get it. It feels like an urgency issue. I remember what that felt like. I'm going to say that hit me when I was 35 when it really hit me. And I put the brakes on. I said, you know, yeah, I'm going to keep up my role, my work. I can keep my work going and my obligation to my marriage. But I'm going to fit this in no matter what. May I have a tissue?
Sure.
No matter what. And you have a determination about you. Thank you, Ray.
You're welcome, Linda.
You have a determination about you that surpasses anything else, that no matter what, you are going to see it through. So you're going to be fine. You're going to be fine. You're not going to miss it. You're not going to squander the life that you have. You're not going to miss it. I'll tell you what I've noticed. This is interesting. There was this video on, we have a client who died not too long ago, and she was trying so hard to get it. She was trying so hard to get it. She came to every one of our events. She had tons of coaching sessions with her guides, with us, and she really, really came a long way fast. It was amazing. And then she was going to get this dog that she was going to teach to be a service dog. Now that's interesting, isn't it? And she never did get the dog because then she got sick again, and then she died. All right. But this woman on this video, it makes me think of this. She had this, was it a deer that she rescued?
Yeah.
She rescued a deer. The deer came to her property. And what happened? The deer was in really bad shape. And she took this deer on. Do you remember the story?
Yeah.
Could you remember the story, Ray?
Yeah, and she nursed it back to health. And
it was time to release the deer.
Yeah.
And the deer kept coming back.
Right.
And brought other... Didn't the deer bring other deer back?
Right.
Turned her into a deer sanctuary. It turns out her guides, the universe, had a job for her. Okay, service to others. And it was this. Never in her wildest dreams. Okay, so my point is, this woman was stage 4 cancer of the brain, was it?
No, something.
It was really bad.
And any stage 4 cancer is bad.
Yeah,
no matter where you have it.
Stage 4. And when she had this animal, she just said, you know, to heck with this cancer thing. I'm going to take care of this animal. I'm going to pour it all into this animal and take care of this animal. Then came the other animals. And the animal had other ideas for her. The stage 4 cancer was gone. It I don't know, a couple months, and it was over, and it didn't even exist. The whole thing I'm trying to say is when you're of service to others and you really are pouring it out there and your guidance, the universe puts you on a mission, it may surprise you what it is. You just may look at it and go, really? That's what you want me to do? Don't argue with it, Linda. Whatever it is, don't get in its way. When they came to me and they asked me to create this talking board in 1988, December of 88, and they said to me, they said, and I'd had this relationship with them my whole life. They said, we need a way to reach humanity on a higher level to help them through the challenging times to come. It's the only thing they ever asked me to do, my guides. They never asked me for anything else. I was all in, you know. Here I was in the home building business. I was designing homes, building homes. You know, I was busy. Man, no, I kept that going. I was married. I had this done in my dreams. They showed me how they wanted it to look, the way they wanted it, you know, the size of it, the way they wanted it to be optimized for a plant pendulum. They knew what they wanted, all right? They didn't want any suggestive stuff on it, no colors, no nothing. They wanted it as a teaching tool. Don't confuse it with, you know, silliness and nonsense and scary stuff and everything. And they said they needed it, but they also said they needed a new talking board that did not cause fear and caution. So this is it, okay? And I went right to work on it. I had it done in 3 months. It was done being produced in it took another 6 months before it was completely produced and copyright, or I mean trademarked and everything. So I'm just going, you know, that's the kind of thing. Don't, you know, they give you a job, go do it. Don't worry about what it is. And you don't have to worry about having the time you need. The woman that had stage 4, she has all the time in the world now. Our dear client, she tried so hard to get it. But you know what? She only signed up for the time she was here. We get amnesia when we come here. She didn't know that. She didn't remember that. And she didn't have time to be that of service to others that she was so drawn to do before this life was done, you know? So don't worry about it. You're going to have the time you need, all right? You're at the perfect time in your life for this service to others for you to connect with. And take the urgency off of it. Go to part 3 of My Guided Journey. In the journal writing part, and start writing in there, asking your guides, what do you want me to do? What is my service to others? What is my job? Give me my job. Show me my job. All right? And they'll show it to you. They'll give it to you. Be open to it, though. it's probably going to be something you didn't expect.
Right.
All right.
And that kind of answers the middle part of her question. And then she says, thank you so much for both of us for our time and our sincerity. She appreciates it. She's going to find out more about coaching. And then I think that's probably, in a personal coaching session, the best place to bring up questions
right.
about your marriage, because that's a little off topic tonight. But
right.
in a group set, the relationship questions are tough to answer in a group.
It can be, because they come through and they tell you what they see. we can't stop them from doing that. They're going to tell you what they see.
Okay. Joy Woodward Crespo Howard. Remember Joy? She's the Joy that has four names.
Yes.
Hi, Linda and Ray. I would like to know if the energy healing of issues that were left over from previous lives helped propel her forward so that she will not have to return so many times.
Okay,
so she's been here before. She's had energy healing in past lives. Do those help her not have to come back as many times? I guess that's the question.
Okay, so your spirit guides and angels are going to answer that question directed at you, Joy, and here they go.
Joy, it's not how many times you have to come back. It's how many times you want to come back. You are never forced into coming here. You sign up for it again and again. It's not a sentence.
Okay, so I want to go back to her question. They talked about the energy healing from the other lifetimes. How has that accelerated her evolution?
It has caused her not to have to come back as often.
Okay, that's interesting. Yeah, okay.
All right. It'd be easy if we had like a passport that they stamped every time we came back, and we'd know how many times we've been here.
Why does it matter?
It doesn't really matter.
It could depress you, Ray.
It'd be nice to know, well, my last life, it was in, Sweden.
Well, you can find that out.
The life before that was in Japan, and...
It doesn't matter. It's finished business. That's finished business. What you didn't finish is why you're here now.
Oh, that's why I'm in the Valley of the Sun now.
That's, well, it's better than being in the
Valley
of
the Snow. Yeah. Here's another thing, a phrase that people use all the time that kind of contributes to their angst. Running out of time. I fear I'm running out of time. I'm 50, 60 years old, 70 years old, and I fear I'm running out of time and I haven't found my purpose yet.
Right, that's right. Okay, so you're not running out of time. Well, what's happening is that's an urgency that's coming to light. It's time to start really bearing down and paying attention to why you did come here. The party's over, okay? Quit letting the distractions and the stuff take you away from the reason you came here and just burn through another life without getting it, what you came here to do. All right? That's what it's about. I've seen people, my mom would be an example of one, where I always, held out thinking that she might get it at the very end. Maybe in the last 5 minutes, my mom, the light would go on and she'd get it. I know that can happen. I really know that can happen. Our client who passed away last year, she did get it. She really did get it. She turned into, she was very hard when she first came to us. Very hurt, okay? Very angry. And even when she listened to the first session that she had with us, she apologized. She goes, I can't believe that was me. And I just said, I know. You've come so far. And she just quit being hard on herself and mean to herself. That's a big part of it, you guys. You can't do what you came here to do when you're beating yourself up. It's not like that. You can't do that. You've got to just get in there with your heart, with your heart energy, and just start seeing things for what they are. That's the first thing. Clean the slate and start seeing things for what they are, and don't judge anybody anymore. And quit being mean to yourself. Would you have a friend in your life that treated you like you treat yourself? If you wouldn't, and that's the problem, then stop doing that. You can't treat somebody else nice when you keep beating yourself up. That's your standard. That's what you're pulling from when you address someone else, you know? So even if they mess up, I've got a guy right now, I'm working with him, and he messed up. His time frame went out. He's a week overdue on the project. And he can't believe that I didn't jump on his back for that. You know what it doesn't do? It doesn't bring the best out of the other person. It doesn't. It doesn't bring the best out of me. And it actually, we had another client, another guy with Guided, the editor for Guided, Laren Bright. He said, you know, working with you guys on this book gave me faith in humanity again. Imagine that. All right. Now, there was a point where the book cover designer wanted the book from Laren. He goes, I need the book. You tell Laren to finish that job. He's overdue. And then the formatter said, you need to, Laren, he should have caught some of these copy or some of these editing issues, and he didn't catch them. You should refuse to pay him. Everybody was like ready to rip the heart out of Laren. And I said, then I told the book cover designer, I said, back off of Laren. You leave him alone. And with the formatter, she's just really hard. I said, I didn't say anything to her because she didn't understand anything less than just ripping the heart out of somebody, all right? Breaks my heart to see this. And I just said to Laren, I said, you know, Laren, I'll tell you what, why don't we just think about the book as being completed? Because you know what? The guy did his best. If he could have done better, he was holding on to the book thinking that maybe he didn't do good enough. You know? That's, yeah. People need, they need to be, oh man, I what can I say about this? Treating each other, the book was probably, I don't know, maybe another, a couple of months from our due date. Yeah. From our due date. But I'll tell you what, if that's the world we're in, I don't want to be in it.
Everybody's always running.
It's terrible.
That's part of that phrase. Right. They're running out of time.
Well, right. Running over everybody
else.
They
see themselves as running.
Trying to get ahead. Ahead of what? Ahead of the other guy and pound him into the ground? Run over him? Right?
Trying to get ahead.
It's terrible.
Ahead of who?
Maybe you
should stop running.
The point I'm trying to make is if we change the priorities around and we don't run ourselves up against a money crunch or a time issue where we don't have a little room in there to be gentle with our fellow man, that's the key, you guys. And you know what? If you just do that, that doesn't pay you any money, but that is what we need to do with each other. We need to change our values. We need to raise the bar, not lower the bar, okay? So that hurts me. And I just will not have that in my life. I will not have situations where I'm being, you know, pressured to behave badly and hurt somebody else or be treated badly and be hurt by somebody else, all right? So that's what this is really all about. It really hurts me. That's what we're here to learn, all right? And if we only learned in this world the way it's turned, what it's turned into, if we only learned that one thing, then we came here and we got what we came for.
Right.
So quit judging what you came for. If you stay true to yourself and you make room for the other person and you're considerate to everybody, all right? That you've already passed the test. Everything else is gravy.
Right. You'll get everything you want if you just stop running after it and chasing it
and grabbing it.
Right. Get those words out of your vernacular. I want, because that just reinforces your feelings of lack, that you don't have enough of that.
Instead, and it's totally not true.
Right. Instead of saying, I want, say, I'm allowing for more of this to come.
Let it in.
Right.
Let it in. And when you, okay, when you think that you shouldn't spend the money on that, oh my God, and you're that freaked out about it, then go spend the money on that and have an abundant attitude instead of a poverty attitude, one that's always lacking, okay? You got to break that habit of lack. I have no lack in my life. I really have no lack. Sometimes I need a little more sleep. That's about it.
Yeah.
But that's really the truth. I don't set myself up for lack. I don't want a new car that's going to stress us out. I don't want to spend money on stuff and go out to dinner and have the bill at the end of the month, $900 going out to dinner all month. I don't want that. I know a lot of people who live like that. And they just keep jacking up their credit cards and wonder why they feel so nervous. Oh my God. You know, I don't want that. And I'm okay with not going out all the time and focusing on our work and doing what we do. You know, and that's service to others all the way, okay? So you guys, you just have to change some priorities around and you're not going to feel this lack. You're not going to feel like you're running out of time. And you're going to be, every time you go out there, you go to the grocery store, and have you noticed how poor service is? Well, people aren't getting, let's get on the side of the person. They're not getting paid enough money. They're not getting trained because the company's not investing in their employees because they feel like they're on the verge of collapse. I mean, everything's just falling apart. So we've got to be kinder to each other. That's the number one thing. And if you can just learn to do that one thing first, you are going to feel better. All right? Yeah.
Oh. Okay. That was on a light note, wasn't
Boy,
it? There we go.
I just had to say that.
Yeah. Bonnie Thompson. Hello, Bonnie.
Hi,
My daughter and I have had a few conversations on the subject of reincarnation. We have both had several dreams of previous lifetimes. She has expressed to me that she did not choose her family in this lifetime because she may have committed suicide in her most recent past life. I have had similar feelings. Some insight would be nice. It's been a roller coaster, to say the least.
Okay, when she says she has had some similar insights.
About suicide and past lives.
Okay, for herself?
And her daughter.
So for both of them?
Yeah,
okay.
Similar.
Okay, so you guys figured out how to, you know, exit. Take an exit.
And reunite this time, somehow.
Yeah. So there's no judgment around that.
No.
Bonnie, your spirit guides and angels are here with us now. And I'm going to speak to them for a minute. I want you to answer Bonnie directly, specifically to the question she asked. What is this thing about these, first of all, are these suicides true?
Yes.
Okay. For both her daughter and her?
Yes.
Okay. So let's start with Bonnie first.
All right. The question is, some insight on that would be nice. I have a few conversations on the subject of reincarnation.
Okay. And so in this lifetime, since that was an event in another lifetime or possibly other lifetimes, what would be the right way to phrase this? How does that affect this lifetime?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
For
Bonnie. And she said, and do you choose to come back or not?
Okay. And okay, for Bonnie, and was this a choice for her to come back in this lifetime? Two questions for you, Bonnie, and your guide, spirit guide. No.
Okay.
The daughter comes next.
All right.
Bonnie first.
You have always chosen where and when you will return. It's not just random. It has a plan. The attempt at any suicides or suicides are part of that plan, and you knew it before you came here.
And how is do those previous suicides, how have they affected this lifetime for Bonnie?
Less pain in this lifetime.
Ah, so you picked a lifetime with less challenges, less pressure, okay, on you, that didn't push you so hard, that caused you to want to exit, okay? Now, how about your daughter?
Daughter.
Same question.
Daughter thinks she had committed suicide last lifetime and didn't choose her family this time.
Okay, that's what she thinks.
Right.
Here, and they're going to answer that about your daughter, and here they go.
As we said, you always have a choice when you come back. In fact, you discuss it with us so we can be sure you know what you are getting into. And it's important to understand why people commit suicide. It's not because they want their life to end. They want the pain to end.
Okay, so her daughter said that she did not choose the family that she was born into in this lifetime.
That's not correct.
Okay. So, you know, sometimes the ego gets in there and it demands to be right. It demands to know these things. But it's just playing games with us. It takes up time. It's distractions. So, you know.
Mona Bauer says, last week you mentioned some people come here just to have fun. I'd like to know if I have a purpose this time or just fun, because I've been a very hard worker in her last life. Thank you.
Okay. And Mona, your spirit guides and angels are going to answer that directly. And here they go.
It's just as noble and important to live a life of joy and fun and loving fulfillment as it is to suffer. The lessons are many times the same.
Mm-hmm. So the question was,
she wants to know if she's okay to have fun this time since she was such a hard worker last life. Of course, it's up to you to make your own fun.
Right, right. So, you know, if you're going to be happy, it's up to you to be happy. You know, that kind of thing.
It's kind of a choice when you wake up in the morning.
Yeah. So, you know, here's how you're going to know it, you guys. What's right for you? It's that urge that comes from your truth center. It drives you, okay? Like, I had a friend one time. She called the project that I work on, she called it my beast of burden.
Beast of burden.
That's what she called it. And it was just before, well, it was about the time I wrote Guided. And she hadn't even read Guided, but she knew me, all right? And when I set my mind to do something, I go after it. And I've always had this since I was 35 years old, and actually since the time I was born into this life. But it really hit me strongly when I was 35, like, you know, game over. It's time to really pour myself into this project of service to others and what I do with dream work and help people connect with their guides and understand why they're here and, you know, what's going on in their life and know what to do in their life so they're not lost in this world, you know? And she goes, yeah, she goes, I don't want to be part of your beast of burden. And I was like, wow. Now there's somebody, total party girl. I mean, like, all she could think about is party, dancing all the time, going out and playing. And I would go out. I mean, I'd go out dancing and stuff. But I had other things to do too, you know. But that's all she wanted to do. And that was okay. But the way she perceived my life from that perspective, from just playing all the time, is this was my beast of burden. How about that? Isn't that interesting? So for her, it was like, wow, I would never want to take on the responsibility and the load you have, Linda. Not ever, okay? And she wrote me off. I haven't seen her in years. Interesting how this works out.
Questions are just pouring in.
And by the way, I want to say something to all of you. Ray and I were going to hold back on this, but I'm going to mention it. I'm going to give you guys a little peek at this, and you can leave some comments on what I'm going to tell you. Here in the next several weeks, Ray and I right now are under construction on improving this whole production that we do on Tuesdays with you. And we're going to have it interactive, where you guys can speak to us voice instead of having to type things in.
Yeah.
And when we see what you're typing in, Ray's going to open up the line so you can communicate over. There we go. See the hearts? Throw out your feedback. Do you like it? Throw your likes out. Throw your hearts out. If you want to see this, let us know. There it is. Okay, we just signed up for it today.
Right.
I mean, it's like this service is like $175 a month. We signed up for this, and we're signed up for the next year and more. Hello.
So, you know what they can do?
Yeah.
They can tell me how nice my hair is.
I know they can. Type it. And you know what? Ray is a sweet man. He's so sweet. He's not perfect. But he's really, really beautiful.
I've been kind of a mentor to you. I mean,
Ray,
you've had these great mentors since you were a child, but have you ever had any other mentors? Think about that.
I know. That's true, right?
Have you had... I mean, I like to think I'm kind of...
You are excellent.
Kind of a mentor.
No, you're way cool. I mean, you're right with me. Ray's right with me. Stands right beside me and sees me through this stuff and helps. Look at this. You guys, in the next couple of weeks, we're going to launch this. And we're
as soon as we learn how to use it.
We're going to master using it between the two of us. We're going to get the bugs worked out. But you guys are going to love this. All right?
Yeah, they
look
are.
At this. I know. We love you guys. Oh my God.
I'm thinking about I kind of serve a dual purpose.
Why?
I'm your mentor and your tormentor.
You know what? He is not race great. Men do that to us, though, don't they, you guys?
Sometimes.
Look. Yes, they love it.
Okay,
you
let's
guys.
See here. Veronica would
I
like to
it.
Know.
Okay.
Veronica Baca. She wants to know, she wants to ask the guides and angels about the reason she came here this time. She reincarnated this time. Why?
Give me the name again.
Veronica.
Veronica. Okay, Veronica. No. You should have gotten your pendulum.
Did you get... her pendant today.
Yeah, your pendant.
Was it delivered to you today?
We hope you got that. Oh, good. Okay. What was her question again, Ray?
She wants to know, what's the reason that she came here this time?
The reason she came here this time.
This time
okay.
When she reincarnated.
Okay, so there's a lot of reasons why you come into a single lifetime. It's not just one thing. You know, we get stuff out of the way, and then when we're done, it's like in Guided, when I came into that family I picked, yikes. But when I was done, that was done, and that was one of the things, if I was to ask that question, they'd say you came in to, you know, whatever in my early life, right? But that's done now, Linda, and you've accomplished that, and now you're doing this. So it's not just one answer, all right? But your spirit guides and angels are here with us now, Veronica. Hello, Ray.
Yeah, I'm there. I'm right with you.
And they are going to tell you all about that. They're gonna get right to the point about
the reason she came here this time.
Right, what that is. But it could be more than one reason, and I'm sure it is.
It is one reason that has many facets. You came here this time to learn more about yourself than you teach others about themselves.
Wow. Huh. Okay, so you're here as a learner this time. A learner, a student.
And a teacher.
Well, you automatically are a teacher,
mm-hmm.
But they're saying on the it's more weighted on the learning side, Red. More to learn than to teach this time. Okay.
Yep.
So that's what that's about.
So the more she teaches, the more she's going to learn about herself.
Well, that's not what I got. I got that she's a learner. All right. Okay.
It stands to reason that the teacher learns along with the student.
Right. And even many times you'll learn more. Like we had that one client who tried so hard, who was so hard and really nasty in the beginning. And God, what she learned was like over the top amazing. In fact, I got to tell you guys, this one woman who, she pushed me so hard to learn what she needed to learn.
That's kind of why you wrote the journal.
That she forced this out of me, okay? I mean, you guys with your questions and the thousands of fans who've asked me questions have put pressure on me to show you how you can do it, all right? But she really forced me because...
She was a scholar of guidance.
Of guidance.
She could tell you everything that you said, what page it was on, what did you mean by that, I thought you meant this.
I know, she was really, and she was so bright. And she had a successful business career that was over the top, amazing.
Before she got sick.
Before she got sick. And then she was really, really dedicated. But she put so much pressure on me that I would just think and feel and connect with what she's doing and what she's talking about to the point where I started this outline back in, I'm going to say February of last year is when this started.
Yep.
And man, it just started coming out of me like, you know, and I really have to credit a lot of it to her, you know. Wow. These people that you find yourself in their lives, there are no accidents, you know. But you have to, in my case, I just followed through and I followed through with it. And it hurt my heart to see her hurt the way she did. But in session, I couldn't let that show. Or I wouldn't be, you can't go where somebody is and help them. You've got to stay even and steady and solid, okay, and connected to really help them. And that being a coach, that's a huge, huge thing. But now that's something that happened. I can talk about it with my heart. You know, I can talk about it.
That doesn't necessarily just pertain to being a coach. You can't go where they are if you're going to help them. It's
right. That's right.
It's like being a friend.
Oh God,
you can't. That's agree right. with your a family or, member or a friend
or a parent
or a parent right. or a child
right right
you can't agree with them just to let them think you're on their side.
That's right. If you're not helping them
right
just so they'll like you
right.
That's not helping anybody. That's the point Ray's making here.
And that's the big thing about when people start on a spiritual path and they want to have a purpose in life and they know that they're life has more meaning than their group of friends, you know, who get together
and to do the same thing every
four
week,
nights a week, go to happy hour, you
for
know,
20 years.
For 20, yeah,
I know.
And as soon as this one person, well, we have somebody that we talked to yesterday in a coaching session, that she's unlike anybody else in her family.
I know.
And she doesn't want to talk to them anymore because they make fun of her.
I know, and she just needed to know how to handle that, and her guides got her right in order with that. So she's good now, you
yep.
know.
Yep.
And you know what? You might even be on just watching us tonight, and you know your name, and we're not going to mention it. But if you are, then you know, say hi.
Yep.
Yeah. She said she was going to try to come in.
Right, Devana Roberts. Can her guides tell her? Help her realize her soul's purpose during this time that she's here.
Her soul's purpose. Okay. Now, you know what that is. I know that you may have pushed it away. You may have, you know, kind of, I don't have time for it right now. Or, yeah, you know, I thought about that and I'd love to do that. Or, you know, you already know the answer to that. I'll tell you right now. But your spirit guides and angels are here with us now. The name?
Devana.
Devana. And they're going to talk to you about that, what your purpose is here in this lifetime.
Your purpose is not that mysterious. Your soul's purpose doesn't reside outside of your heart. Your purpose this time is to give love and experience it.
Exactly, what is that? In words that she'll understand.
Be open and compassionate to everyone you meet and see how that makes you feel. That is the lesson.
Okay, if you just got into our session tonight, in the earlier part of this, we talked about this, all right? And how I talked about it, about how important it is just to treat the people in your life and anybody, the clerk at the grocery store, you know, it doesn't matter who it is. Treat them with love and compassion. Just say their name when you see them. Say, Mary, how are you today? Show that you say something to them that makes them feel like a person.
Make eye contact.
Yeah, exactly. And connect with these people. We are disconnected. It seems normal to be disconnected. And it's far from normal, you guys. In this lifetime, we're going to see just how destructive this separateness has been. We haven't seen it yet. It hasn't shown up yet. But we can all see in the society that we're in where it's heading. And get it right. Get it right for yourself, because we need more people on the get it right side of that fence, so that when the people who still that crash and burn right into not getting it right, we'll be there. All of us will be there to help them, because they will be ready then. If they're not ready, you can't help them, right?
Okay. Yeah. Interesting comment, not so much a question, from Mona. She'd like to stop reincarnating here. And she wants to go to some other world. I think aliens are more peaceful than humans.
Okay. That's interesting, Mona. And here your guides go. And we have no judgment on this. How could I? What is this on the front of my book that I took a photograph of? Okay. Yeah. All right, here we go.
Didn't make that one up. What makes you think you don't have a choice? A soul is the same wherever you go. Who says you have to come back into this planet and get another Earth suit? Your soul can just as easily be directed to other places of intelligent, loving life.
Yeah. So this isn't the only place we come back to. It's just that you came back here this time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you look at what? You look at the map of our galaxy, you know, what it looks like, you've seen it.
Oh, yeah.
Here's the sun. We're way down here.
Yeah.
We're almost on the outskirts of town. We're not even where the action is uptown.
Yeah. But anyway, we have all kinds of options that we don't know. See, we come here with amnesia, forget all the things that we knew when we were unlimited. We come into these bodies, you have to kind of force yourself into these bodies, and so you take just a fraction of your energy, intelligence, with you and bring it in here. The body could not even, it would explode if it was to take it all on, all right? So when you go back, when you're released from this world and you go back to source and you are one with everything, you can go where you want to go. You can come back here, but you don't have to come back here. There's other options. And that's up for debate. There's a lot of people who would get into that kind of conversation and say, well, you know, how could there be, you know, other life? Aren't we the only ones? I mean, of course, it's just something each person has a different opinion about. And after what I've experienced with my guides throughout my life, I know that there's better places and other places to go than just this world. I know that. I learned that when I was 20 months old, when I met them. So,
the interesting thing is when you met them at 20 months old, they looked familiar.
I knew who they were. That's right. And I knew, what's interesting is when I saw them and they were all around me, when I was in an urgent situation, when I saw them, you would think I would just go, wow, look at all of them. It was not at all what happened. I saw them and I saw myself. I knew who I was when I saw them. It's like telepathy. I could see and read what they were seeing when they saw me. That's what it was. So it's energy, you guys.
Okay.
It wiped out my amnesia is what it did. It took down the veil.
Okay. Here's a question from Nicole, a comment, which you've had a lot of experience with. I think you can really contribute here. There's something very significant in the number three, but her question of contribution in regards to understanding what the other side is in need of, you know, when you leave here, they answered her question before that you do contribute.
Yes.
On the other side.
Yes.
Okay. What are they in need of? I've told you about the train of angels. Remember she said last week or the week before that she has light coming through her room, and they were tapping her. And
yeah, oh yeah, I remember.
Moving around. And through me, they're taking some form of light or energy that's spread out to the other angel and guides to you.
I remember that. Through them, and it came through you.
Right.
I remember that.
So you've had a lot of encounters with lights and light beings.
And energy.
And energy beings. And it's sometimes it's white light, sometimes it was blue light. But that's the energy from their essence, right?
Here's my experience. When they came to me and they worked with me, I call it they worked on me. They worked on you too, right?
Yeah.
And they worked on me. That's what I call it. I call it they worked on me. So what they did is they either amped me up or they prepared me for something. Or just before we get into these on Tuesdays with you guys, the guides come through and I can feel the energy hit me like a rush of heat hit me. It's like they're gathering. It's a gathering where they're coming together. It would be like all those angels that were around you and they were shooting light through each one of them and like hitting you with that light. It's knowledge that they're hitting you with. It's an awareness. It's an enlightenment. It's an amping up. The way they explained it to me is the reason they came through and they hit me with all that energy that many, many times they've done it is they said, for you to have the knowledge, you need the wiring to be able to contain it, okay? To contain the knowledge that we're loading you with. And so it's the wiring, it's the capacity. That's what they're doing. And they have the capacity. They're so evolved technologically. They've got technology that's just like totally amazing, all right? And they're using some of that technology to reach us that are aware of them, all right? Or in my case, at 20 months old, when they came through and their choice of communication is always telepathy, but when the lowest form of them trying to reach us in this world is through our dreams. So they know they can reach us through our dreams if only you can remember them. So they're constantly hitting you with insights and information through your dreams. So much information in your dreams, it's amazing. And you'll always know where you're going because of those dreams. Important to write those dreams into part three and keep it going in chronological order, you guys. Really important. And one thing about what we're going to be moving into, where we're going to have full interactive video conferencing with you guys moving forward with this new technology we signed up for, is we'll be able to, and we're going to set it up where everybody can afford to do this. We're going to set it up where, instead of having a coaching session from us, because coaching sessions are, you know, they're $110 for a half hour, $200 for an hour, and a lot of people can't afford it. So we're going to set it up so it's reasonable, so the people who participate can come in, get answers, and afford to do it, all right? Like, get answers to your dreams. It's critical that you guys start
writing in your journal.
You've got to start writing your dreams down and then breaking through the dream code. This is what we're good at. This is what the guides are there to help you do. The next level of connecting with your guides is telepathy. Because what'll happen is you'll start getting it. You'll start understanding it. And those dreams will start coming to you more. And this communication will start building. And then you'll just start knowing things. You'll just start, you know, getting another insight. You'll just start getting a block of information, like, you know, a paragraph. Your experience on your talking board will go much better. Everything will start to brighten up. So, Ray, we're getting to the
getting close to that. Yeah. We have another maybe another 15 minutes or so.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Anime. Hi, Anime. What do my guides say about my reincarnation, and what gifts do I have to develop yet?
Okay. I'm going to change the way you worded that.
Yeah.
What gifts do I get to develop still? Okay. And your spirit guides and angels are going to answer you on what those gifts that you get to develop are. All right.
Anime, you are a compassionate person. It's in this gift that you already have perfected that you will find more ways to use it and stop worrying about more gifts.
Okay, it has to do with judgment. You have to stop worrying about what people are going to think about you when you start really using your gifts, all right? You're going to write in here, you're going to write into part three, what those feelings are that cause you to become reserved and not express what you intended, what you felt inclined, urged to do, and stop yourself and halt yourself.
Like you need something else. You have all the gifts. You came with all the gifts.
You got to catch yourself
right
when you halt, when you hold your breath, when you decide not to, okay, because of what somebody's going to say or think. You've got to write it in here, because that's when you're going to be able to identify it in part three and see it out here and then go, oh, okay, I see what it is now. Oh, I see what it is. It no longer runs you. It doesn't have a hold of you like this, cutting you off. It now it's out here, and you can see it, and it's proof. And you can deal with it. The next time that opportunity comes up, and you have that ability to work with your compassionate nature, and use it in the way that it needs to be applied to that situation, that person, you won't hold up. You won't. And when you don't hesitate, that person won't. They won't question your authority.
Yeah, I mean, people...
It's when you hesitate that they go, oh, she doesn't know what she's talking about. Right?
You don't need this big arsenal of gifts that you've perfected that, you know...
Before you go out,
right, yeah,
and
you,
and
you
start
pull this
helping
one out and work on this person with that. That's like saying somebody who's a fabulous concert pianist is also desires to be a great artist. Or a great stand-up comedian. They don't have to have all those talents.
That's right.
They have to have one talent, one powerful talent
right.
that they leave to the world.
And that's what you lead with.
Right.
And from that show up the other talents that you didn't even know were there.
Right.
But you lead with the one that you're gifted with.
That you brought with you.
Right. But you have to start writing down what those impulses are in part three, Enemy, and dating them so you can start tracking what's going on with you. So you no longer get stopped out, right?
Okay. Right. And yeah. Texas made a saying for that. You have to dance with the one that brought you.
So dance with your compassionate nature.
Right. And Teresa.
Teresa.
Hi, Teresa.
Nice to have you, Teresa.
Hi, Linda Ray and everyone else.
We need to.
Cat,
we need...
Yeah, one more. Cat Angel. Hi, you're new. Thank you.
Right.
Welcome. Can the guys tell me how I can overcome my regrets and guilt about having wasted time, energy, and money in my past? I worry about having wasted opportunities to fulfill my purpose in this lifetime.
Mm, okay.
Interesting.
All right. Give me her name again.
Cat. Like meow.
Kitty cat.
Like meow.
Okay. Okay, Cat. Your spirit guides and angels are here with us now. And they're going to tell you how they see that. And here they go.
What makes you feel that you've wasted them? Did you learn anything from having them and then not having them anymore? Whether it was time or money, you should not have regrets or feel guilty. Do you have regrets that you once had the money and now you don't? What if you didn't have money and now you do? Would you be regretful or sad about that? You are given exactly what you need at any time. If you feel you need more of anything in your life and that you will be happy or fulfilled once you get it, then you are chasing things and will always feel like you are lacking. We want you to begin to feel grateful for everything you do have. Each day, make a mental list of 20 things you have you are grateful for, and watch these feelings of lack disappear.
And regret
that you don't have.
Okay, so I don't know if you know about My Guided Journey. It is a free download. It's at the very top of the feed. Ray put the link in to get this off my website. Get it? Part three. You need to put those things in there. You are on a diet of gratitude. It's gratitude that's the only thing that you're missing now. Gratitude for the opportunity to experience what you did in the past, and gratitude for the support you have now that supports you in where you're going. It's all about gratitude, you guys.
Okay, let's see here. Just comments. It's good comments.
Okay.
Yes, yes, please. Yes. Love that. That idea sounds awesome, says Anna Mae.
Yeah.
Bonnie, thank you both so much. Your help is immeasurable.
And you guys, what we're going to do is we're going to wrap it up tonight, Ray.
Yep.
Okay. And we're going to, at the end of this, we're going to, as I announce next week's event, what we're going to be doing on Tuesday, the guides are going to perform on their closing message about reincarnation. And the universe's recycling system and why you came here this time. All right, they're going to wrap it up with their final closing message. But before they do that, let's see what we have here, Ray. Next Tuesday, same place, same time, on May 1st, here on Facebook Live, that's when you can ask your spirit guides with Linda Deer, Ray Holly, and the guides, 6 p.m. Pacific, 9 p.m. Eastern. The guides will be talking about insecurities mask who you are. And this will be published in Tuesday morning's Linda's Weekly Guided Insights. If you haven't received those, did you post that, Ray?
I can.
Okay. If you're not getting Linda's Weekly Guided Insights, they are free. They're insights that the guides that we channel each week about navigating the uncertain world we're all living in right now. And they choose the insight each week, what we're going to talk about as it relates to the world we're in right now. They're very timely about this. And that insight's going to be, people enjoy dressing up for Halloween once a year, so they become someone else or something else. This mask they put on temporarily conceals their shyness and inhibitions. They do things they wouldn't normally do had people known who they were. It's the rest of the year that your insecurities mask who you are. So this is all about masking who you are, and really, when you do that, when you mask who you are, you push yourself away, you postpone things, you play it cool, you play it safe, you fit in, you know, it's based on all that, and you miss your life when you do that.
I'm just smiling because you said dressing up for Halloween. Halloween, that's my favorite holiday. I really, that's the day I can really let it all go. The one day a year when I don't have any inhibitions. I could post some of those pictures.
Ray has some pictures from Halloween that he did. In fact, the one year
I won it all.
The year before, a couple of months before we got married. Ray had this costume, and it was scary. Okay, how would you describe that costume, Ray?
Well, I won.
I know, but what was the costume?
I was an old stripper trying to make a comeback.
And he won all the prizes.
I won all the money, $500, all the prizes, every category, scariest, most original. Funniest.
But not sexiest.
I did not win sexiest, no.
And it was just too much.
Sexiest went to a girl that was cheating.
Well, now, that's an opinion, Ray. And it's a girl, by far.
It was a girl.
She was by far more sexy than you, Ray.
Yeah.
So, anyway, if you can make it to that next week, we're going to get into inhibitions and how your inhibitions...
And insecurities.
And insecurities, right. They need to be looked at. They need to be documented. You know, when you take the journey, part two, you're going to find out where those inhibitions started. Okay, what held you up? What held you back? And I remember having them. And I remember in my family that I grew up in, it was like my air supply was cut off. I could not express who I was in that family. And when I got out when I was 16 years old, the first thing I noticed is I could breathe. It was the strangest feeling. I could feel my physical form literally changing. It was strange, all right? So I was finally able to come out of that shell. It was scary. It was really weird. So these inhibitions aren't good. They're holding you back. You're holding your breath. You're not coming out and living the life you intended when you came here. And your guides are going to snap you right out of that, all right? But now the guides are going to close the session with their closing message to all of you about reincarnation, the universe's recycling system, and why you came here. And here they go.
We want to end this with letting you know that the more you clear your own path in this life, the further you go in this lifetime. Also, the further you go, the more you understand others' paths. You realize that with all the distractions that we are all connected, we are all one, and all paths are converging.
Right, and we are all really just walking each other back home. You know, that phrase is so powerful. If we understand that and remember, always remember that, no matter who you run across, that we really are collectively decided to come here and be on the planet together, all together this time around, then, you know, let's hold each other's hands and be kind to each other. Let's know that, look at that person and know that we are all just walking each other back home. And that is a huge contribution to humanity right there.
Okay, we apologize for anybody's questions we didn't get to.
Right, but we will next week. We will next week, and we will see you guys on Tuesday next week. And we've got some fun stuff coming up. Probably in a couple weeks from now, we'll have it all perfected. Right, Ray.
Yep.
And we're so excited.
And I'll post the link to Linda's Weekly Guided Insights. I didn't have it tonight.
That's okay, Ray.
As soon as we get
done. That's no problem.
And I may post that picture of me, the uninhibited Ray.
Okay, you guys, you're gonna see.
You can't share it with anybody.
I feel it coming. He's going to share this picture with you. And it is, well, here's my point. It was a couple months before we got married, and the people at the Halloween party said, Linda, are you going to marry him?
The funny thing was, people who've known me for 10 years didn't even know it was me.
Except for one guy.
One person. One
and
person.
And what did he recognize?
Recognized my voice.
That's how well done this was. And I have to admit that I was part of the problem because
I did my makeup.
Yeah. And his stockings, you know. Yeah. It was really
scary. The army boots were my
scary.
My touch.
Yeah. And the perfume.
Oh my God.
That was really bad. It was so bad.
Yeah.
So anyway, it's fun. You guys.